Great. Thanks for being here this morning. Thanks for coming to our monthly Frank Talks a week late. So, I mean, okay, do you like the second or the third Monday better? I don't know. This is looking like a good crowd, so, and a great space. Thank you to First Presbyterian Church for having us today. Mary Sellers is here, and everybody's back there. Thank you all so much. This is a great space. It's convenient, I think, for people. Now, who got in the nursery school line? That was good. That was a good one. So, I'm Mindy Tate. I'm CEO of Franklin Tomorrow. And oh, thanks, Kim. Thanks, Ann. That's what that one is, probably. Thank you so much for being here. I'm Mindy Tate, CEO of Franklin Tomorrow. And we are so glad you are here. And this is one of our fun ones. I see people in this room who have been on our People to Know panel in the past. I know, Barry, you did that. We've got others who have been on this People to Know panel in the past. And we love getting to know people in our community. Franklin Tomorrow's mission is to engage the community, foster collaboration, and then advocate for a shared vision for the future of Franklin. And we do that by listening to what the citizens say and working with other groups and organizations. And I need my clicker. I'm just, maybe the third Monday is not my day. Who knows? Maybe the third Monday is not my day. But we will come back and thank them again, but we would like to thank our folks from Renasant Bank, our presenting partner, and Williamson Medical Center, our sustaining partner. But we're going to kick it off. Nancy Conway is going to do our Did You Know trivia question.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. This is a very exciting audience here today, and I expect everyone to have the answer in advance for the trivia question. Did you know? Okay, now, Mindy? Okay, anyone standing? Anyone else? Okay, help me as to who answers this question first. So, well, it's Franklin's Main Street Festival time. Isn't it ever? April 23rd and 24th. And this fabulous event is famous throughout the entire southeastern United States, brings at least 85,000 people to our community. And just think of the fun for people of all ages. Now, here is your quiz question. Is everyone ready?
If you work at the Heritage Foundation, you can't eat it.
That's right. Okay. What was the first year of the Main Street Festival in Franklin?
Anybody? Raise a hand.
1985.
Incorrect. Sorry, Mayor. Incorrect.
Tom? 38
years.
Yes, but that's not the year. No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. No.
Rebecca.
Correct. Rebecca.
Those math skills.
Thank you, Rebecca. Those math skills. So it was 38 years ago. Tom knows that. I should have disqualified Tom as well, probably. Probably should have disqualified Tom. But it is April 23rd and 24th, and it's one of the reasons we're having Heidi as one of our people to know today, is to talk about the festivals and the great things, but also the great work she's doing. But as I said, we'd love to thank our partners, and so we're going to start by thanking Williamson Medical Center and Renasant Bank. And Williamson Medical Center, I believe we have a video.
Although I'm proud of the cancer program that we have at Williamson Medical Center, it would be my goal for a patient never to meet these people. Prevention is the key.
And when we talk about colon cancer, we're talking about the colon polyp. So the purpose of a screening colonoscopy is to look for either an early colon cancer, so we get it out of there, manage it, or else remove polyps that then in turn would reduce patient's risk of developing a colon cancer.
A patient in clinic, I tell them polyps, think of those like the skin moles that a dermatologist removes to prevent skin cancer. It's the same concept. Unfortunately, over the last few years, we've noticed that younger people tend to have more polyps. Also, younger people having a higher incidence of colon cancer. And so in 2021, one of the largest preventative health services in the United States, the U.S. Preventative Services Task Force, reviewed a lot of this information and felt compelled to lower this recommendation for screening from age 50 to age 45. This age has been adopted by multiple societies in oncology and gastroenterology. And fortunately, most insurance companies have come around to coverage, and I think they eventually all will.
There are certain populations that are an increased risk for colon cancer, those patients with inherited colon cancer syndromes, and then inflammatory bowel disease patients. They should and will be having colonoscopies earlier for colon cancer screening.
Will be part of our video that we will have posted on our website by Wednesday. But April is Colon Cancer Awareness Month, so let's all take that seriously and be mindful of it. So we also want to thank our friends from Renasant Bank. Tony, do you have Tony, Diane, y'all have anything to say, or just play this funny video?
Lighten the mood.
Okay, here we go.
Tennessee.
We're going to pronounce towns from Tennessee.
Gatlinburg, Dolly Parm, I love it.
I'm from Tennessee, y'all. Hopefully y'all get some of these right.
Baileyton.
Baileyton.
So that should be Baileyton.
Bailetown?
But it's not.
Baileyton.
No. Was Baileyton?
Baileyton.
Think Tennessean.
Sound it out.
No, that is not how you say that. Belton?
That ain't how you spell bail.
Hurry.
Who year? Per year.
Like that cat's real purry.
You get four per year.
Per year. Woo!
Severville?
I've been there. Severville. I can never say it though.
I thought this was pronounced Severville.
Savoryville? And we stay in the cabins in this place.
Oh, I know this one. Severville.
Severville. Okay.
Oh.
Ooltua.
Ooltua.
Oat. And the rest is silent.
The L's silent, right?
Altiwa. Altaway. Ootway. Ooltua. We can do this all night.
Who starts a city with two O's?
I like a double O.
Ooltua. Ooltewa. Ooltewa.
Ooltua.
Ootua.
And the Bible is Bathsheba. So Beersheba Springs.
But it's like Beersheba. This is like the drunk history version of the Bible.
It's Springs, right?
Beersheba Springs. Ooh, Beersheba Springs.
Well, beer.
Beersheba Springs.
Beersheba, there's a lot of bears in Tennessee.
There's no beer? Sorry.
Beersheba Springs.
Beersheba, why?
It's beer.
Sir Goinville.
My eyes first saw Sir Groinsville. Surgeonsville.
Sir, is the G hard?
Sir Goinsville. I got an ache in my groinsville.
Surgeonville? Sir Goinaville?
Surgeonsville.
Sir Goinsville.
When I see this, it looks like Frankenweenie.
Frankiewing?
Frockwit. Frank Ewing.
Isn't he a singer? Is that him? No?
Oh, I ain't good at these no more.
Frankiewing.
Frankiewing. Frankie Wing? That was a joke pronunciation.
Oh, that's one of them famous singers there. Selena.
Kalina.
Kalina.
Selena.
Shoe.
Selena.
Selina.
Selena.
Selena.
Solana? Like Solana.
I'm going to clear my throat.
I'm just pronouncing things horribly now.
Groot Lager?
I am Groot Lager.
That sound, well, that looked like it should be up north.
What even is this?
Grootly Lager? Is it really? I see, that one makes sense to me.
So that's not going to be Santa Fe, is it? That makes too much sense.
Santa Fe, I reject any notion that that is incorrect.
Santaffy? Like, how would Tennesseans say it?
Well, however they saying it ain't right.
I feel like this is a trick. This is a trick.
Santa Fe.
Really?
Tennessee, Santa Fe, Tennessee.
This looks like unicorns.
I would tell everyone I lived in Unicorn Town.
Unico.
Uniqua.
Unicoy.
What? Yay! Oh, wow. Good grief. Tennessee, are you kidding me?
I'm sorry, Dolly Parton. I'm really sorry.
They didn't sound like they look, or even like they may look.
Maybe I'm a Tennessean now?
I didn't butcher all of them. Some of them I got done okay.
Renasant Bank, the best bank in the South. Visit renasantbank.com to learn more.
Okay. If you are from one of those towns and you're upset by if they made fun of it, then you have to talk to Tony because he picked the video, not me, okay? He picked the video. But what a lot of fun those are. I'm not advancing. I think you have to maybe escape. There we go. Okay, and thank you to the Good Food Group, our coffee sponsor for Frank Talks and Breakfast with the Mayors, and you may know them as our local McDonald's, but thank you to Jamon Daughtry, who's always so generous to sponsor the coffee for our events. So it's people to know. That's why you came here, I think, or just to get out of the house or not to have to go back to the office just yet if you were on spring break. But we're glad you're here. So I'm going to bring up our panelists for this morning. And ask them to join us up here. And we have our speakers today are Chad Gray, who's the Williamson County Election Administrator. Chad, if you'll join us, and Heidi Hood, who is the Managing Director of the Downtown Franklin Association of the Heritage Foundation. And finally, least but not last, is General Manager Jeff Friedman of Williamson Memorial Funeral Home. So thank you guys so much for being here this morning. Both these microphones now work. That's scary, isn't it? Both of them work. But the way we have those slides loaded is we're going to start with Heidi. And Heidi, I'm going to get your slides to the right place. Boom, boom. That's the right place, isn't it? Great. And there's the clicker. And it's very much a clicker. So there you go.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Could we play that video?
Thank you.
Downtown Franklin is a very special place. You set foot on our streets, you step into our public square, and something just feels different here. It feels like home, and everyone is welcome. The beauty of the Downtown Franklin Association is that we have strength in numbers. We are so much stronger together than we are as individual and separate businesses. So we combine our brain power, our resources, and different elements of this community to not only impact downtown, but also Williamson County as a whole. One of the things we are most proud of is that we are known as America's favorite Main Street. We are part of the National Main Street program, and that means we focus on four areas downtown to really make Franklin shine today. We value design and the look and feel you experience when you set foot into our historic district. There's a feeling of nostalgia, a sense of yesteryear, and you just feel like you stepped back in time. We also have promotions for our businesses and retailers, and these are fueled by our signature festivals each year. These are beloved community events, from Main Street Festival to Pumpkin Fest to Dickens of a Christmas, and we have a chance to grow these and be a service to the community and make downtown a destination. We also focus on economic vitality. We want to make sure that our businesses are doing well, that storefronts are occupied, and that if there are spaces available, we're bringing in other great local talent. The last piece is organization. From my team to our advisory board, community partners, and local government officials, we all work together to lay a great foundation to build up these businesses and create the right programming to help them prosper. We make sure that this business community and the great culture of downtown Franklin continues for years to come. If you are a business in the historic downtown Franklin district, we invite you to join us. It's a great time to get involved, have networking opportunities, and take advantage of programs designed to help your business grow. We are an asset and a resource and a friend to you. I hope you'll join us and get involved. For everyone visiting downtown Franklin, we invite you to shop, dine, unwind, and enjoy the vibrant culture and lifestyle of America's favorite Main Street district.
for having me today. Thanks to Mindy for asking me to share a few words this morning. I am so blessed to be a part of this community and to serve on the Heritage Foundation team with the Downtown Franklin Association. If I haven't had a chance to shake your hand yet, I hope we can soon. I am originally from Santa Clarita, California, but I spent 13 years in the Dallas, Texas area before moving here in October of 2020. And one of the things I appreciate about Franklin is that we prioritize a vision for both historic preservation and intentional growth towards the future. So it's an exciting thing to be a part of, and I'm really blessed to be here. Mindy asked me to share a little bit about my background today, so I'll just keep it brief before diving into some exciting things the DFA is working on this year. But my background is in performing arts and entrepreneurship and nonprofit and chamber of commerce work. After earning my bachelor's degree in vocal performance along with a theater minor from Southwestern Assemblies of God University, I became an entrepreneur. I started multiple online and in-person businesses and educated myself in the world of business through what I call the business school of hard knocks, and through hiring business coaches and taking various programs, really just self-educating myself there. It was during my time building a character entertainment company in Texas that I became a member of my local chamber of commerce, and I fell in love with community work and collaboration among businesses and also the charm of a Main Street community. I served as the member engagement and marketing manager for the Waxahachie Chamber of Commerce for over a year, and during my time there, I was grateful to launch and manage the membership, ambassador, networking, and marketing programs. After moving with my husband to Tennessee in October of 2020, I was blessed to join the Heritage Foundation in March of 2021, serving first in the marketing department before transitioning to my new role as director of the DFA in August of 2021. So you may be wondering a little bit about what DFA is all about or how we do the mission work that you were able to watch there on the video. And so briefly, I'll just say that our vision is for downtown Franklin, Tennessee to continue its legacy as America's favorite Main Street district. And our mission is that as a nationally accredited Main Street America program, we lead the continued revitalization and purposeful evolution of downtown Franklin in the context of historic preservation. And to fulfill this, we invest in four pillars of value, as you saw in the video: economic vitality, design, promotions, and organization. So what does all that mean? I'm going to spell it out real fancy for you, and then I'll just simplify it in a minute. But from an economic vitality standpoint, we focus on capital incentives and other economic and financial tools to assist new and existing businesses, catalyze property development, and create a supportive environment for entrepreneurs. From a design standpoint, we work to enhance the physical and visual assets that set this commercial district apart. From a promotion standpoint, we position the downtown district as the center of the community and hub of economic activity while creating a positive image that showcases a community's unique characteristics. And I just realized I have the clicker, so here you go. And from an organization standpoint, we create a strong foundation for a sustainable revitalization effort, including cultivating partnerships, community involvement, and resources for the district. So let me simplify this, or kind of break down the different initiatives and programs that we run towards these goals. And I will start with the Smart Start initiative. So really exciting. We worked this year with Tennessee Main Street America to become an official Tennessee Smart Start community. So this means that we strive to increase community collaboration and support a thriving small business and entrepreneurial environment by providing new and existing businesses with education tools and resources. So within our community now, individuals and entities have stepped up to become what we call community partners. And this is a diverse group of organizations and individuals that we're working to equip with the tools and resources to make downtown Franklin one of the easiest places to start and grow a business. Also, we're working to launch support groups for the various sectors of our membership, and the goal of each support group would be to create space for businesses in similar sectors to collaborate and learn from each other. Of course, everyone knows about our signature festivals, Main Street Fest, Pumpkin Fest, Dickens of a Christmas, and these bring hundreds of thousands of people each year to downtown Franklin and have played a part over the decades of making downtown Franklin the destination it is today. Towards our design pillar, we're working to update the wayfinding signage downtown presently with updated information. And we're also primary keepers of the Memorial Bench program in collaboration with the city. For the holidays, we run the Window Wonderland contest, and we collaborate with the city on holiday decor for Christmas time. And then towards our promotions pillar, we leverage our audience of nearly 100,000 now of followers and subscribers by telling the story of our business members on social media, website, and email platforms. We're excited as well. This spring, we relaunched the Franklin Locals program, and this program is to better promote downtown to visitors as they are on the streets. And Franklin Locals is a volunteer greeter concierge program consisting of trained on-the-street reps that are just that friendly face that presents that good Southern hospitality to the visitors of Main Street. We're also proud to launch this year, we launched our Downtown Franklin Annual Awards, which was just a really exciting thing to do for our membership, to celebrate excellence and milestones for them. And this November, y'all can look forward to our Small Business Saturday campaign. We collaborate with American Express to really encourage everybody to shop small and shop local that weekend after Thanksgiving. And then as well, the Hop and Shop Trolley, which helps transport shoppers from the factory to downtown during one of the busiest shopping seasons on Main Street, and just helps with creating more parking. So thanks to the factory for partnering with us on that. And it's gone. All right, and of course, if you haven't heard already, we are a Better Cities for Pets destination with Mars Pet Care, which is an awesome promotional piece for us, and that's thanks to a lot of the leaders and volunteers that have gone before me. And finally, for organization, we do serve a growing membership of 160 business members at present. And that's within a one-mile radius of the public square. And we provide them with benefits through connections, promotions, influence, savings, and resources. I'm excited to say that DFA University is also going to relaunch soon, providing business building content for our members. And we're always working to keep relevant resources for everybody. So as you can see, we invest in a variety of ways in downtown Franklin to make sure that it remains one of America's favorite Main Street districts. We could not do any of this without the help of our invested business members, our donors, our supporters and volunteers, and of course the Heritage Foundation team. So thank you to those who have invested, both past and present, in the DFA, and I hope you'll join me in anticipation for what's to come. Thank you.
So I have a question for Heidi. So Heidi, you're a member organization, the Downtown Franklin Association, but who can be a member? But also people support you by participating in festivals and in other and supporting the businesses. But who can be a member? Because I'm sure there's some prospective members here if it's open to the public.
Yes, of course. So our membership is largely for businesses. So we have memberships for nonprofits as well. If you're a nonprofit or a business in within a one-mile radius of the downtown Franklin Public Square, I'd be happy to chat with you about membership and how we could serve you that way. And if you want to get involved in another way, there is always a need for volunteers for our festivals, for Franklin Locals. We're recruiting right now. That there's a lot of room to become a Franklin Local, and that is a super fun group to be a part of if you want to join that hospitality program. They're on the streets Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and the team is growing, so you're welcome to join us.
And you get a cool shirt, right?
You do. You can, if you want, you can get one of the cool shirts and all of that. So we got some swag.
Swag is always good. If you'll pass that microphone to Chad, and I will introduce. I've known Chad for a long time, so I might know some things about him that are outside the norm, but Chad, we always like to hear a little bit about you as a person. But one of the reasons I invited Chad is there's a lot of elections this year, y'all. And we, Franklin Tomorrow, is an apolitical organization, but it is very important to us that you be engaged in those elections, that you make your choice and you participate in the democratic process of electing our representatives across the board. And so Chad's going to tell us a little bit about himself first. I'm going to make him do that. And then secondly, just some important, how many candidates are there? It's crazy.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Chad Gray. I'm the Administrator of Elections. A little bit about me. I'm a fifth-generation Williamson Countyan, and I'm a product of Williamson County Public Schools. I've graduated...
Corn. Unicorn.
I graduated from Page High School, went to college at Western Kentucky University in Bowling Green, and I have worked in the Election Commission since 2000, and in 2015, I was appointed the Administrator of Elections. I have a staff of six full-time, including myself, and we have a ton of poll workers that make all this work. It's not just about me. It's about our team and making our voters have a good experience when they go to cast their ballots for their candidates of choice. So just a little bit about the Election Commission. We're very different and unique in county government. We are not under an elected official at all. We are under a five-member bipartisan election commission board. We are funded by county government, but that board appoints myself, and then I, in turn, have my full-time staff that work under me. So, and if you're wondering how the Election Commission is appointed, they are appointed by members of the General Assembly based on recommendations from the local political parties. Just a few stats about our registered voters and that sort of thing. Here in Williamson County, we have about 190,000 registered voters almost at this point. If you all follow the census numbers, we had almost 250,000 voters, or rather population in our county. And generally speaking, about 70% of our population 18 years of age and older are registered voters. In November elections, we have a very high voter participation. Four out of the last five elections in November, we've had the highest turnout in the state. So we had nearly 80% turnout in November of 2020. So that gives you an idea of a little bit about what we do. And we have elections every year. In last year, we had elections in the city of Brentwood and the city of Franklin. And this year we have elections for the county offices. We have a May primary that's May 3rd. And then we'll have our August 4th county general and state primary for members of the General Assembly. They will be electing political party nominees. And then on November 8th is our state general election for governor and members of the United States House of Representatives and members of the Tennessee General Assembly. Mindy, I'm not sure if I should keep going on and on and on. But
yes, you should keep going on, okay. Or I'll ask you some questions. I'll use my old reporter skills to ask you some questions. So where are we in terms of deadlines? Ballots are set, I would assume, for the May primaries, and there are two primaries for May, right?
There is.
Represent that and tell us a little bit about that.
I believe, it was a little hard keeping up with how many candidates, but we have roughly 80 candidates running for county offices at this point. And in Tennessee, a political party can call for a local primary for county offices. And both parties have called for that, the Republican Party and the local Democratic Party. So both of those ballots will appear on the May primary. One of the misnomers in our state is that people are registered under a political party. Well, that is not true. When you go to cast a ballot in a political party primary, you have to declare an allegiance to a political party and declare what preference you wish to vote in. The law says bona fide member of that party. That's a little bit of a term that we don't use very much. So when you go to cast a ballot in a political party primary, they will ask you which party primary you want to vote in. So that's really how that works. One other thing that's a little bit of a myth about our office is that when you register to vote, you become eligible for jury duty service. That is completely wrong. In my entire experience, in 22 years almost of working in this office, we've had the federal courts ask for our roles one time, and that was really early on in the early 2000s. So please do not register because you think you're going to be signed up for jury duty service, because the circuit court clerk has a different methodology with selecting those individuals.
Just a couple more questions. So you said there's about 190,000 registered voters and 250 or so, the census tells us, in citizens. But so, I mean, is that number decreasing, our number of registered voters? Has that number decreased or staying solid even though we're growing?
Well, it tends to vary a little bit. You know, we have more of a demographic in our registered voters where people are more, they move in and out a little bit more than they used to. So that number does fluctuate. But generally speaking, those that are 18 years of age and older, around 70% are usually registered to vote in our county. Now, what usually happens when we come up on 2024, we will have 15,000 to 16,000 voters register in probably a 90-day period. So people do procrastinate on that front. Please do not do that if you're in this audience. It makes our lives very difficult when people register at the last minute. But we're glad to do it. It's just a lot of work in a short amount of time.
And specifically, how do people register to vote in Tennessee? How can you register, and what makes it easy, and can you register a friend or neighbor? How does that work?
Well, it's much easier than it used to be. Back in, I guess it was almost 4 years ago, online voter registration came to Tennessee, and that's been very successful. I'd say probably 75% of our voters register online these days, and then other voters register when they go to the Tennessee Department of Safety to get their driver's license issued or renewed. And then we have a very small percentage that are submitted by mail. So by and large, our online voter registration that was started by the Division of Elections under Secretary of State Trey Hargett, that's been very successful for our state.
So a lot of people used to register to vote, I would assume, when they came to the county complex at 1320 West Main Street to get their car tags. But now you have a new office. Tell us a little bit about where that is and why you all needed that.
We do. For many years, our office has only existed now in three locations. We were in the historic Williamson County Courthouse on the square. It was a very small room, basically one person office. In the late 80s, when Williamson Medical Center built their new facility, county government moved into the old hospital, as it's known, on West Main, and we occupied some space there. So that was in the late 80s. We obviously have outgrown that space, so we are now located at 405 Downs Boulevard. It's close to where Domino's Pizza is located, across the street, basically. But we like our new space. We have more room to operate, and we're very delighted to be there. We have about 80 spaces for parking, so that's going to be a plus for our early voters when we get to the early voting periods that will come around this year.
And then one final question, I think. So you mentioned poll workers, that they're part of your team and they're a very important part of your team. But who are those people? I guess I'm looking around and I could see a few sitting in this room, couldn't I, that could be potential poll workers, because it's something you really need.
Absolutely. And I want to brag on our poll workers. You know, 2020 was a very difficult year. And our poll workers are generally older folks. They are in that demographic that could be considered very vulnerable in that circumstance in 2020. But a lot of them put that aside to really put forth the idea that their civic responsibility is to make all this work. And, you know, some of them were very hesitant, and I can't say that I blame them, but some of them said, you know, we got to get through this. So anyone can sign up to be a poll official. I know it's a long day. It's about 13 hours. But we really enjoy having members of our community serve as poll officials. And there for a long time, a lot of our poll officials were from that demographic. They grew up in the time after World War II. And beyond, when they knew the tremendous responsibility it was to have free and fair elections. So A lot of those individuals are retiring from being a poll official, but we had a lot of people step up to the plate, and so we can always use them. We got a large number of poll officials in 2020 that wanted to help, and we're glad to have it. Because, you know, sometimes they're on the front line. Sometimes our voters aren't always kind about their voting experience. So they mitigate that for us, and we really are glad to have them. One other thing I do want to mention is that our county is one of, I guess, four counties now that have Election Day convenient vote centers. So if you can go to any location open on Election Day and cast a ballot regardless of where you live. So if you are driving from Franklin to Nashville to commute, you can stop at the Brentwood Library on Election Day and cast your ballot. You don't have to live in a geographic area. And that's been a tremendous success for us. And we're very glad to have vote centers now. Our voters are used to voting early anyway, so this concept translated really well to our Election Day experience.
And then I guess one final question. Reapportionment is underway and ongoing, and it has almost a ripple effect, I would imagine, from the federal districts down to the state districts down to local will also face that. So where are we in that process, and should people expect a new card, or what's the process?
Well, our plan is to have those cards to you by the beginning of early voting. I hope that works out well for us. Redistricting this year on the county and the legislative and the congressional level was very challenging for us this year. A lot of the growth that we saw in the county occurred in the eastern part of the county, in Nolensville specifically. And for that reason, a lot of our county commission districts had to shift towards the east. And so we have county commission districts that are somewhat different than they were before. So we had that occurred, and the census data was really late getting to us, and the county commission finally approved their new county commission lines in November, and then the General Assembly came in with their lines for the Tennessee House of Representatives, the Tennessee Senate, and United States House of Representatives. So we are now divided between two congressional districts in our county. We were all in one before. We're in the 5th and 7th now. And so it's been really a challenge here lately to get all of this in order for us to know who's in what district and who can run for what office. But we're at the end of that process, and that's been a blessing to have that almost behind us.
Well, thank you so much. And if you're not registered to vote, Chad can tell you where to go and how to get there, haha. But he'll get you registered. He and his staff will get you registered and able to participate in all the elections coming up this year. Okay, thanks so much, Chad. Okay, so our final speaker and people to know is someone I met last year, and we kind of hit it off just immediately, but anybody who meets Jeff Friedman kind of hits it off with them immediately. Well, almost everyone he meets for the first time, I'm not sure, since he is the general manager of Williamson Memorial Funeral Home. He may meet some people for the first time. They may not be as excited to see him, but we're excited to have him here this morning. And Jeff, we'd like to learn a little bit about you and how you came to Franklin and Williamson County, and then tell us a little bit about the Williamson Memorial Funeral Home and Gardens.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for having me. So I'm a licensed funeral director, embalmer, and certified crematory operator, which are all three horrible lines at a pickup bar. They do have no good at all. But a little about me, quick history. I was born at an early age. My second year of first grade, I decided not to take life too seriously. I went through high school playing football, and then my sophomore year, they created this thing called no pass, no play rule. So I had to go a different direction and was convinced I was going to be a stand-up comedian. But my father made me go to college, so I took all death courses to show him how much I didn't want to be there. One night we took a tour of a funeral home, and I will never forget, you know, I had never been in a funeral home before, walking in, thinking, oh, it's going to be spooky, it's going to be smelly and cold. And it was actually quite different. And then this guy walked in the room who commanded the room, had a great smile, voice was loud, and just shook everybody's hand, and it was his business. He was the funeral director. And as he walked us around the funeral home, he kind of broke the tension with some one-liners, which I appreciated. But when we walked into his office, it was incredible. On one wall was just nothing but certificates and plaques from organizations in his community he belonged to. Another wall was just thank you letters from organizations he either sponsored or was a member of or helped in some way. And then another wall was just thank you letters from families he served. And I was like, wow, this guy's made an impact. What an incredible person this is. And to my professor's surprise and the annoyance of my class, I had questions. And one of the questions I asked is, how do you promote your business? And he said, I wake up every day and run for mayor. He wakes up every day, goes to the local coffee shop, solves the world's problems with the same five guys every day. He went to the Masonic Lodge before lunch. At lunch, he returned back to that same cafe, and then would go to the Elks Lodge in the afternoon or Rotary in the afternoon, and then stop by the Little League fields on the way home to see the team he was sponsoring. And I was like, wow, this guy has made a career out of not just helping people, but serving his community. And I went back to my dorm room that night, told my girlfriend, now wife, that I was going to drop out of college and become a funeral director. Called my father to his complete annoyance, told him I was going to drop out of college and be a funeral director, of which he told me that I would be eating Chick-fil-A and working at a mall the rest of my life because there was no career to have. I love Chick-fil-A. But when I got into the business, realized, wow, we are bearing the last of an incredible generation right now. Men who lied about their age to fight for their country came back with little education and built companies and raised families. And women, I mean, some of the women right now that we're bearing were the first to go to universities, enter the workforce. I mean, the stories we get to hear as funeral directors are incredible. So in 2001, I had already opened some funeral homes and I decided to join this cremation craze. But we opened 24 funeral homes in Texas, Dallas, Austin, and Houston, that only specialized in parties. So if you wanted something off the wall, we were your people to come to. We started our business not from scratch, but from stupid. I could wallpaper my office with cease and desist letters because I didn't know something was illegal. But we ran billboards. I got voted the most tasteless billboarder according to CNN, and not local CNN. It was national. Had a group of ladies in tight shorts that said, check out our ashes. Distinctive life cremations and funerals. We also had all kinds of merchandise, like always the pallbearer, never the corpse, stuff like that. But what we did is we celebrated the life that was lived, not the last 2 years of Alzheimer's, not the nursing home experience. We started talking to families and learning what was important. And when in 2017 we sold that business, and at the same time my daughter was attending college in Louisiana, and met a boy from Centerville. And in 2018, we realized that we really needed to move here, my wife and I, because they were living here. And we were either going to build him up or break him up. We failed at both. They got married last February. And he's actually, a good guy. But when I got asked to join the Williamson team, I had never seen... The funeral business is very unique. There's city funeral homes that are just bang, bang, let's get everything done, move through, and serve the next person. And then there's Williamson, which is a country funeral home surrounded by a metropolitan city. And I learned in the first couple days, one of our vans needed tires, so I went to Discount Tire in Cool Springs. Oh my gosh, you gotta use local. It was the worst thing I'd ever done in this profession. I didn't use a locally owned shop. The Williamson family has served the families for so long. They know everybody walking in that door. And when the acquisition happened and they were bringing in this outsider from Texas, I don't think anybody knew what to expect. I definitely didn't know what to expect. I now just take a second seat to Pam and David and the Stevens family and just like, okay, I'll just make sure the books look good. Y'all keep serving families the way you do. They are truly dedicated to each family. And they take such pride in their profession as funeral directors that a lot of the off-the-wall ideas I have, you know, don't really mix, but they've, you know, we have some new things. We are paying more attention to the life lived. We don't just do funerals. We have a staff of 32 people. And each morning we read the obituaries of the people out loud. So to put that humanness back into it. It is truly incredible to have two families have visitation the same night and find out they're related. Franklin is so strong on heritage and so strong on family. I just have never been a part of this before. And it truly is the funeral business unlike any other profession out there. I could go on forever with one-liners and entertaining stories, but any questions?
So he is a funny guy. I mean, I have enjoyed hearing him one-liners and that type of thing. Now, you recently, just this past weekend, we had our first TEDx Franklin. But now you've talked at Dead Talks, right?
Yes. So in Vegas every year is Dead Talks, which is over 500 funeral directors that come together and try to learn from each other. And I did do a speech there about networking and how important networking is and the art of it. Because I do believe in hand-to-hand, eye-to-eye networking and being a part of the community we serve, which is really the biggest benefit we have in our profession, is we get to be a part of the community.
And then I'll also ask you, obviously the last 2 years in the pandemic have been very difficult on the community in general, but the Williamson Memorial Funeral Home and cremation has been called on to serve so many families. I'm sure that's been a difficult experience. And tell us a little bit about how you all came through COVID and handling the grief of so many in our community.
Yeah, COVID brought a really unique situation to us, not just the number of deaths that were happening, but the regulations that came along with it. So we were having to look at parents who were burying their son, who may be 40 or 50, but still it's their son. And we're having to look at them and say, I'm sorry, we can only have 10 people. Or I'm sorry, you can't do a public viewing, which just complicates that grief so much more. So while the number was hard to handle, having those conversations with families was even more incredible. The toll it took on us, the toll we were watching on the first responders, the nurses in the hospitals, it was really a hard time for us. There was a lot with COVID that wasn't talked about. I mean, whenever the stimulus checks came out, we saw an increase in drug overdoses and other things from younger people, which was adding to everything. And we were trying to watch out for our own health at the same time. But helping those families, and now we're seeing those families return to do the celebration of life. And COVID's not over, and it's not, you know, I hated because it did get politicalized some, but we were seeing the results of it. So communities banded together.
Thank you so much. And I'll just bring that point. Williamson Memorial has been a partner with Franklin Memorial for the last few years in our volunteer awards, which includes a legacy component where we honor individuals who've passed in our community in the last year who've been community servants or community builders. In 2020 we had about 40. In 2021 we had over 150 people we needed to honor in that event. just given the toll in our community. And it is a powerful part of our program, and you can watch that program on YouTube. But thanks to their support, we were able to purchase a book at the Williams County Public Library in the name of those individuals who passed away. So their life keeps going. Their life is interacting with other people as they check out those books. And for us, that was a great way to continue their service to our community. And we appreciate the support of Williamson Memorial Funeral Home. So did you all learn something from these people to know? We just have a few minutes, and we will allow that to... Oh, what did I do with the clicker? Oh, here it is. We'll allow that time to go, and maybe you can ask questions. Heidi, you need volunteers for the Main Street Festival, right? Chad, you need poll workers. He doesn't need any volunteers, so that's good. He doesn't need any volunteers. But you can follow us on social media. We try to keep you up to date on events and local programs going on. Working with Heidi to make sure we help her get some volunteers. But don't forget that while everybody's getting a new license plate in the state of Tennessee this year, you can get a really cool one with a depiction of one of our great landmarks, Carton Plantation. But that is a historic Franklin license plate, which benefits Franklin tomorrow. We appreciate that. If you enjoy our programs, which we try to keep free, consider donating in the back with our dip jar there. And we really appreciate you being here. We already know what we're doing next month. I'm just really proud of myself that we already know what we're doing next month. So we are going to go to the Williamson County Animal Center next month on Grigsby Hayes Drive or Road or out there in the middle. We'll definitely include a map with you. We'll definitely send a map. And we're probably going to ask you to bring a bag of dog or cat food or some kind of other pet food for the guinea pigs or do something like that. But we're going to learn a lot about our new Williams County Animal Center. And they have a beautiful community room, and we're excited to be there. And then on April 26th, there's breakfast with the mayors. And I already know what's going on there, too. I'm so proud. At Rolling Hills Community Center, Community Church, we will have Phil Mazuka, who's the CEO of Williamson Medical Center, will be telling us about the expansion and the development of the medical community through that huge expansion, $156 million, I believe, over the next few years. And also learn a little bit about the overall health of our community from other, possibly another speaker, but are all set, and we will have these Eventbrites up for you to register for those events April 11th or April 26th. So, Valencia. Well, I'm pretty sure, she asked, do we all get free dogs or cats? I'm pretty sure they'll let you take one home if you qualify, okay? They will definitely let you take one of those animals home. But it's a great time for us to see that facility. Thank you for being here this morning. Thank you for supporting Franklin tomorrow and these organizations and others in our community. Remember, be engaged, be active, and we look forward to seeing you very soon. Bye.